Welcome, everyone. So happy to see everyone this morning. I'm a little filled up today just because I'm grateful of who God is and who he's been in my life. I can't do anything but worship him, and I hope you'll join today and make that commitment to worship him constantly. There's no other way to express your gratitude for the life that you've been given, no matter the trials that you go through. We go through so much all the time, but he's always there. Always there. So I don't have words. I'm just full, and I'm just ready to worship him. I hope you're with me. And I'm just praying over the service today. Order of service, we'll have a prayer, opening prayer by my sister Tina. Then we'll have a selection from our praise and worship team. Praise God. Jesus, he is so good. Then we'll have scripture by Sister Kyla if she makes it, but if not, we have a backup, Sister Gwen. And then we'll have another selection. We'll do our meet and greet, and I'll be back. So enjoy your worship experience. Let the Spirit touch you today, because it's here. It is here. It's always here. And all you have to do is just give in. Okay? So enjoy. Thank you.
Would everyone please bow your heads? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you, God. Thank you for being just wonderful, great, amazing, awesome, God. We are thanking you, God, for this service, God. Thank you for those that are here, God, those that are worshiping with us online, and those that are on their way, God. God, we pray that as you give the message to Pastor Marsay and the word comes forth, God, that it will be received in our hearts, God, that we won't just hear the word, God, today, but that we will apply it to our lives, God. We pray that you move in a mighty way, God, that we can just carry your love and your word with us, God, not just today, God, but each and every day, God, all through the work week, God. We thank you, God, for health and strength, God. We thank you for just being the healer, God, that we need, God. Thank you for being that deliverer that we need, God. Thank you for being everything, God. Everything that we need, God. We pray that those that are watching or hearing, God, will just find something and take it with them, God, and realize, God, just who you are, God, and all the wonderful things that you can do, God. We pray that we just open up our hearts and allow you to come in, God, and fill us with your love, God. We thank you for everyone that's serving today, God. Bless everyone that is helping out, God, in any way, God. We're just coming together, God. We thank you for this family, God, and just working together, God, to give your name all the praise and all the glory. All these things we pray, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. As the praise team is coming up this morning, this first selection is called You Reign. And it's just so good to know that whatever we're going through, God reigns over every situation, every circumstance. We just have to be willing, just know that we can turn it over to him and let him have complete control in our lives. We don't have to worry because God reigns. He's with us everywhere. So worship with us.
Thank you.
My God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
My God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
With power.
With power and majesty.
Dominion.
Dominion, authority. You reign.
Oh, with power.
With power and majesty.
Dominion.
Dominion, authority. You reign.
Oh, my God.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign above every name.
My God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns. Lord, you reign.
Reigning over everything in our lives.
Thank you, Lord God.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
for I will be speaking the truth, but I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong.
Okay, I'm back. Whew, thank you, Lord. Do we have any first-time guests today? Raise your hand, that's all we need. Thank you. Welcome, we are so glad to have you. We hope you received one of these cards when you came in. There's a QR code, if you would scan that to just give us some basic information. We'd like to touch base with you, and again, thank you for worshiping with us today. And at the end of service, please visit our pastor. He has a gift he would like to present you with just for coming in, and welcome. We'd like to welcome you, and he'd like to welcome you personally. So with that said, we have 5 minutes meet and greet. So hug on somebody, fist bump, like we always say, however you want to greet each other, but do so. In the name of Jesus, that's who we are. We love you. We're family. And hi.
Whether we rise or fall, we do it together. We are BVCC.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm Tanya Liverman, and I'm going to do the announcements at this time. We're going to kick off with our birthdays first. So, September 30th, Tyler Dickens. So make sure we sing happy birthday and give a shout out. And then on October 5th, we have Malia Red Cross. There she is. Don't forget, this is the first Thursday of the month. So Thursday, October 3rd, we have our fasting and prayer from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. So join in. And then we have this volunteer opportunity. They are still looking for 5 people to assist with this outreach event. It is on October 19th. They're looking to have people assist with guests that are coming so that they can experience the true living water and taste and see how good God is. Amen. Amen. And that concludes our announcements for today.
Praise the Lord, church. On this next song we're going to sing is a contemplative song. It's not one where you're going to be maybe necessarily want to jump up and holler, but maybe you will. But it's really just thinking about how good God's mercy and how great his mercy is towards us each and every day. You know, we sit back and think about all the opportunities and all the things that we've done. We have just jacked things up, right, when we did it in our own strength. But because of God's mercy, we are all here today, amen, because of his mercy. You're online right now. We just give God praise today for his mercy and just ask you to join in with us as we sing and honor him today.
Great is your mercy towards me, your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercy I see day after day. Forever faithful towards me, always providing for me. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your mercy I see day after day.
surely God is in this place. Somebody today is struggling, but you remember how merciful God was to you. Somebody today is experiencing God. See, our worship is not just based on what God has done, but it's based on who He is. He is faithful. He is King of Kings, and He is Lord of Lords. And even though we don't deserve Him, His mercy towards us is still great. Every day we wake up, there is a brand new mercy. So just for a second, before we jump into the word, I just want to give you a couple more seconds to give God your best praise. A couple more seconds just to cry out, to let Him know how much you appreciate Him, to let Him know how much you love Him. Heavenly Father, we bless Your name because You are worthy to be praised. We honor You right now because You are God all by Yourself. And we thank You for allowing us to participate in what You are doing. If you never do another thing, God, You've already done more than enough. So in this moment, Lord, we bless You. In this moment, Lord, we honor You. In this moment, we give You thanks. In this moment, we repent. In this moment, we cry out to You, God, because we need You. We can't make it without You. And no matter what we are going through right now, God, we declare on this day that You are good, even when life is not. Hallelujah. We give You praise. We give You glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated. You can be seated. Let's just give God one more hand clap real quick. Amen. God is so very good. It is a blessing to be in church one more time. One more time. Before we jump into word, I want to go ahead and dismiss the kids. I think the elementary and middle school would be... Oh, okay. Everybody's in the back. Everybody's in the back. Not the adults. Y'all staying with me. But all the kids, elementary, middle, and high school can make their way to the back. Amen. We're going to jump into word this morning. It is good to see everybody. It is good to just be together again. But I'm excited about preaching today. I hope you're excited about hearing what God has to say. If you've been out for a while, welcome back. If you're here last week, welcome back. If you're a first-time guest, welcome. We are just so blessed to be in church this morning. But I want to talk to you today. I want to give you our sermon title this morning, is The Strength of Weakness. The Strength of Weakness. And the series we're in is entitled Hanging On by a Thread. We've been talking about what it means to really... go through stuff, what it means to be struggling, but in the midst of your storm, in the midst of your struggle, to be able to grab hold of God. And I want to encourage you today, I want to teach you today how to tighten your grip on God. But before we jump in, I do want to have a word of prayer. Just join with me real quick, because I don't know about y'all, but I need God's help. I cannot do this in my own strength, but I am grateful. I'm grateful that I know where my help comes from. So let's pray real quick. God, thank You so much, God, just for this moment, this opportunity, Lord God, to seek You. To gather together as a church body, as family. God, thank You for Your presence in this place. God, I pray that You would speak Your word to Your people. I pray, Father God, that You would allow us, God, to hear what You want us to hear, to do what You'd have us to do, God, and to be who You'd have us to be. God, I pray You'd hide me now. Let Lord God, let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. And hide me, Lord God, behind the cross, that they will see more of you and less of me. God, we honor you now in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. So let's jump in. And I really tried my hardest this week, y'all, to not include one of my kids in the sermon. I really did. I tried my best, but unfortunately, I just could not, right? I could not. This summer, we were down in Greensboro, down in Aggieland, the greatest place to be on the face of the earth. Amen. I got about three of us. and we are struggling this year in football, but I'm not going to talk about that. Me and Brother Kale are having prayer and intercession later for the team. But we were in Greensboro, and my son was blessed to qualify for the National Junior Olympics this year. I was really proud of him. He made it, right? And one of the things that happened, though, while we were down there, right? So we get there, and we were there a little bit early. So he had to compete on a Friday. So we went in, we got in early Thursday, and I wanted him to get a chance to get acclimated to what was going on, right? Because it was a big, big, huge stage, all these people, and he was nervous. So we get down there early, right? And we get there, and his coach had his packet, right? And you need credentials to get in. And unfortunately, if you don't have credentials, it's $20 a head, right? A day, $20 a head a day, right? So all of y'all parents that got your kids in sports, ain't it frustrating to pay for the registration fee, to pay for the uniforms, and then you show up to the game, and guess what you got to do again? You got to pay again, right? So because he was a participant, he should have been able to get in for free. But we got there, I called the coach, and he said, hey, man, I left the packet at the house. Now, we had to park and walk for like 30 minutes, right? So I get there, I show up at the gate, and they're like, hey, well, don't worry about it. Because he's an athlete, they've got his information over at this place, right? So they were in the student union. So I'm at the stadium, and they said, if you go over to the student union, they will get you in. Kale knows the student union ain't close to the stadium. So I get to I'm here talking to the lady. She sees my son has an Aggie shirt on. She said, oh, you want your dad with the auntie, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, Aggie pride. She said, but you go over to the student union. So I walk down to the student union, me and my son, we walk in, we are encouraged, we go up the steps, get to the place. I'm excited, y'all, I take this picture. I'm like, hey, we can take a picture behind the backstand, blah, blah, blah. I talk to the people and they say, you need to go over here. Now, do I have any HBCU alumnus and alumni? Y'all know the runaround, right? Or if you got a child at HBCU, you know the runaround of going to financial aid, only to get sent over to administration, only to be sent over to the janitor's closet, only to end up somewhere where nobody can help you. Y'all know the struggle is real. So I was right there, y'all. And I went to one line, and they couldn't help me. And they said, look, all we handle is packets. And then finally, I went all the way back to where I started. And I was so frustrated. But you know how you can feel your anxiety and your anger popping up on you, and you getting ready to lose your mind up in here. Y'all know that feeling? But after it was all said and done, I get back to where I started. And when I got back to where I started, I didn't lose my religion, even though I wanted to. And I'm talking to the lady, and she says, so they didn't do this, and they didn't do that. And I'm like, nope, they sure didn't. She said, well, I tell you what, just wait a little while. So I had to go, and I waited again. And this time, I'm frustrated because I got all this money I'm about to have to pay. I got all this time that I have wasted, and I got to make a decision. But finally, she said, you know what? I got you. So she comes out and she gives me the bracelet so that my son can get in free, but she recognized that I was an Aggie, so she gave me favor. She didn't have to. Pastor, where are you going with all this? I'm letting you know that sometimes we as kingdom citizens will get the runaround in life, but because of who we are connected to, we will still get access in spite of the inconvenience, right? So as you look at this, I had to endure long lines. I didn't lose myself. I remember who I was, and it gave me favor. So as we look at this, there is strength in our weakness. Strength in our weakness. Let me give you the bottom line. Here's the bottom line. The bottom line is that grace transforms our weakness into a display of God's strength. Grace, 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 grace transforms our weakness into a display of God's strength. Let's read the text. It says, though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth, but I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming what? Conceited. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. Not one time, not two times, but three times. And God answered that prayer, didn't he? He says, but he said to me, my grace is what? Sufficient for you. For my power is made what? Perfect in what? Your weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then I am content. I am content. I am content with stuff going well. With weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. So I have already prepared myself for absolutely no amens except for my wife today. I have already got my mind right? So Brother Paul, we read this text and we're like, Paul, you tripping, bro. No, this ain't it, man. This is not the message I want to hear. I ain't trying to be content in weakness. I'm not trying to be dealing with insults. I'm in cutoff season. I'm just cutting people off. I'm unfriending. You telling me here to be content with that? Paul, you are tripping. I want you to understand something. God sent a thorn to keep Paul humble. And this is not easy to grab hold of, but there is a thorn that Paul is dealing with. And we're talking about hanging on by a thread. And sometimes in life, we can be in a place where we literally are going through so much that we just want a rescue from it. But we pray about it, and then God is like, nope, you're going to stay right there. Right, you're gonna sit right there, and I'm gonna deal with you. I'm gonna develop you. But here, see, Paul was caught up to the third heaven. He saw things that couldn't be uttered. He saw all this great and amazing stuff, and then Paul gets a thorn in his flesh. Now, it's not clear what this thorn was that Paul was dealing with. Some say it was illness. Some say it was persecution, right? Some say Paul had epilepsy. Some say he couldn't see. But can you imagine being a person going around healing everybody else, but you can't be healed yourself? Can you imagine a person going through and encouraging everyone else, and you yourself are going through anxiety and fear, and your own relationships are all messed up? Can you imagine that? This is the thorn that Paul was dealing with. And here we find Paul praying, right? Because Paul had had enough. Paul was straight fed up, y'all. He's like, look, this is too much. Lord, this is too much. So he prays. And he's getting tired of dealing with this situation. He says, I went to God three times on this, right? Three times I went to him, and he didn't answer it the way I wanted him to. And sometimes we can be upset with God because God doesn't give us the answer that we want. And unfortunately, sometimes in a church space and circle, right, we tell y'all it's going to all be good. Give a little bit of money, and God's going to bless your socks off, right? We tell you, praise go up, blessings will come down, right? Scripture and verse, please, I have not seen, right? Understand something. This is a maturity message, right? And sometimes we got to get mature in our faith. But Paul prays three times. He's tired of dealing with this struggle, right? But the thing about it is his response, the way that he answers, right? If you look at what he does something that many of us would not. Because he says, I'm content. and weakness. I'm content in insult. I'm content in all of these things. Because when I am actually weak, that is when I am actually strong. And I want to talk about that here this morning, because he doesn't take a trip to the bar to deal with his struggle, right? He doesn't have a pity party and pull away from Christ in the church. He seeks God, and God gives him the answer, not that he wants, but the answer that he needs. You see, I've learned this. I've learned that God is good even when life is not. God is good when you lose a child. God is good when you get sick. God is good when you get laid off. God is still good. And the thing about it is that the only way you can see the goodness of God is by his grace. Not of your own strength, not of your own comprehension, but in his grace. And the thing about this is that grace allowed Paul to be content with the struggle. You see, grace removed Paul. It moved him from complaining over to worship. You see, grace allowed him, you know, Paul was locked up a lot of his life. He was in jail. He had a rap sheet, y'all. And the thing about this is he would write letters to churches to encourage them, even though he himself was a prisoner. And I want you to understand something, is that the Lord used grace to transform Paul's prison into his platform. And if you can grab hold of this, your prison right now can be a platform for God to literally transform generational curses in your life. Your prison right now can be the testimony that the people who are struggling on your job need to hear. Your prison right now, what you are going through in your marriage, what you're going through in your finances, that can be the platform to God to show how big he is. You see, because everybody ain't gonna listen to Pastor Marsay. But somebody will listen to you to realize that, yo, you used to be all jacked up, in the club, smelling like weed, all of these kind of things, but God changed your life, and now that is the platform that other people can see that God is truly real. You see, I've learned that Paul was content in his struggle because he could trust God in the steps and in the stops. You see, God doesn't only order our steps, but he also orders our stops. And I've learned this, y'all. I've learned that, see, the scriptures say that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and call according to his purpose. But so often, we put periods where God has placed commas. We put questions where God has already made a statement. And so many of us don't trust the sovereignty of God to realize that God is working it out, and we want to jump out of the boat. We want to get off the ship. We want to stop so early, but God is saying, keep on going. Grace allows you, all right, in the season of development to keep standing strong and grab a hold of God. But what does grace do for us? See, grace carries us through storms. Anybody ever rode the ferry before, the Jamestown ferry? So on the ferry, right, you got to get from one body of land to another body of land, and there is no bridge. But the ferry will allow you to drive your car up on it, and it will transport you from one side to another. See, grace will transport you from your place of difficulty to your place of destiny. And you and I have got to understand it is grace that is what is actually carrying us. So I looked out this morning, and one of our first-time guests, I grew up with them, and Sis Penny is in the back, and her daughter Paisley and son-in-law Malik, right? So back in the day, we were in college, me and my wife, and we actually babysat Paisley and Peyton one time. And so the thing about it was, you know, we you know, 19, 20, whatever, and they're like maybe 4 or 5 years old. So we decide we're going to go out, and we're going to feed the geese. Right, we get some bread, we go and feed the geese, right? And we're out in this little area, and we're throwing it, and the kids are having a ball, y'all. They throwing it, yeah, right, they throwing it. And then all of a sudden, the geese get a little bit aggressive. Y'all know geese, they are possessed, right? They need a deliverance service. But all of a sudden, right, the geese went from just being somebody we're throwing bread to now attacking us, right? So I had to grab Paisley in one arm, and I should grab Peyton in the other arm, and we took off. So grace, right, they couldn't make it. Them little legs couldn't go fast enough to get away from them geese. But we had to grab a child in each arm and hightail it out of there. Grace will carry you when you can't carry yourself, right? And we got to understand that is the grace of God, y'all. It will take us through a storm no matter what we are facing. See, grace will allow you to keep loving a child and praying for a kid that looks a whole lot more like the prodigal son than the promise that you had when you brought him home from the hospital. And some of y'all know what I'm talking about. See, grace going to let you deal with that coworker that's been talking about you, right? You done typed up a whole email, blessing them out. Get ready to get you sent to HR. And you like, per my last email, don't let me see you in these streets. You are in the parking lot plotting their demise. But what grace will allow you to do is just reply back, thank you very much, right? It will let you be a blessing to the person who's cursing you. And the thing about it is grace will allow you to deal with difficult circumstances, difficult situations, and difficult people. You see, grace gives us access to God's strength. See, back in my day, we would actually go to the library, and you had that little card catalog. You look up the book you wanted, right? You pick up the physical book, right? You put the stamp on it, and you take it out. But the thing about this is that there are so many resources in the library that are available to you to be checked out. And grace allows you to have access to God's strength, access to God's peace, access to God's wisdom. That is grace. Some of us have been struggling in our relationships because we're speaking from our flesh and not speaking from grace. And the thing that you've got to understand is that grace is God's supernatural ability that is being transformed from his storehouse over to yours. See, sometimes we got folks here who have led a small group for the first time or come up here and prayed and they shaking, literally holding the mic. That mic is just shaking, right? Can't turn it on, nothing like that. But grace allows them to speak when they couldn't speak on their own. Sometimes you go out and try to share your faith, and you, in your mind, you're like, man, I don't know what I'm going to say. I'm going to mess this up. But then you open your mouth, and you're like, you know, I just feel the need to pray for you. And are you going through something? And they're like, man, what are you following me? Because you know exactly what's going on in my life. That is grace, God speaking through you. See, grace gives us access to God's power. Grace is when we literally check out God's power. And the thing about it, I remember my car had to be worked on, and it was a whole lot of money and for a whole lot of time. But what the dealer did was they loaned me a car to get me around while they fixed what was going on with mine. And grace is God loaning you his strength while he fixes situations. But so many of us want to step out of situations and abort situations that God is still working on when he's got grace to carry you for where you need to go. See, what does he tell Paul? See, Paul's like, God, can you fix this? Get me out of this. I'm tired of it. But his answer is that my grace is sufficient for you. All of us know the testimony of wanting McDonald's. And mama said, no, we got McDonald's at home. Right? You go ahead and get that burger, put it on two pieces of white bread, right? That's going to be your McDonald's tonight. My grace is sufficient for you. And God is telling Paul right now, you go sit down somewhere because my grace is sufficient for you. I know you want to answer. I know you want this to be gone, but there is something I'm doing in this season of your life. He's telling him, my grace is sufficient. My power is made perfect in your weakness. See, for example, some of y'all may be known to throw them hands. Right, you may be known to have a master's degree in petty, right? You got a PhD in pettiness, right? Some of us know, yeah, you don't want to raise your hand, but it's okay. But understand something, right? But grace steps in and allows you to bless them and bring them coffee instead, right? Grace will allow you, right, to at the end of the day just say, you know what, God bless you, thank you. Yeah, I'm just going to keep it moving, right? You usually got something that's smart to say, but instead you are a blessing. That's when grace is at work. See, grace will give you strength in the struggle. God will give you grace in the struggle. But too many of us, y'all, too many of us spend too much time trying to look strong on the surface. But in reality, we are struggling, right? Reality, the world sees us in perfection. My man got a toilet seat with a picture of the air of the clouds and a jet behind him just so the Instagram could give him some likes.
Come on now. Come on now.
Too many of us are trying to look like we got it all together. Too many of us are trying to look like we got it all figured out, y'all. And the thing is, we are struggling under the surface. So the question I want to ask you is, what do you seek during your struggle? What do you seek during your struggle? See, when my kids were small, we might as well have bought stock in the Band-Aid company. Because everything, no matter where they fail, they got a scratch, they got a, I can't see nothing, but they want a Band-Aid. Right? If you get bit by a mosquito, right, you put on some of that hydrocortisone or some of that alcohol or whatever that is, right? But if you've had a stressful day, how many of us are seeking self-medication? Right? If we've had a stressful time, right, how many of us are turning to a wine or turning to the brown liquor or turning to the mad dog, right? How many of us are turning to the wrong things in a struggle? Mad Dog 2020. Y'all like, Pastor, you turning to Mad Dog 2020? Look, that's all I know, y'all. I just learned. I literally just learned what mosquito, what is it? What's that other thing y'all taught me? Mosquito? Is that what it? Moscato. See, I don't know none of this stuff, y'all. Mosquito, right? Clearly, I should have researched more on this one. Clearly. But some of us deal with our struggle by blowing up, by walking out, right? And there is no testimony and no power at work in that. Absolutely none. So I want to ask you, what's draining your strength? What is draining your strength? I remember my last cell phone, it started dying really fast. Like I would wake up in the morning, like 2 hours later, dead battery. But what I learned, what I figured out was that my phone was working overtime because everything in it was connected to something. So in other words, every app was trying to refresh itself, and I had all this stuff running in the background instead of my phone doing what it was supposed to be doing. And so many of us have so much stuff that we're connected to our attention, connected to our spirit. We got all the stuff we're connected to, and it is draining us down so fast, and we're hanging on by a thread. So instead of accessing God's grace and God's power, we are accessing the wrong things and we have no strength to show for it. So let me give you a few things that are gonna rob you. You could be connected to the wrong stuff. You can be connected to comparing yourself to other people, right? And comparison is the thief of joy, right? You can be looking like, well, I'm 29, I'm 35, and by now I should have been married. I should have, you know, I should be going on vacation every year, right? I should have all of this stuff. Right? I should be praying like Mike, or I should be leading a small group right now. I should be doing this. Comparison will rob you, right? Complaining about your situation will rob you of letting God use that situation. Thinking you're not ready yet. Thinking that you don't have what it takes, right? His power is made perfect in your weakness. And we've got to understand that when we start to withdraw from God, withdraw from church during our tough seasons, we rob God of the ability to be God in our lives. And sometimes we take things at face value instead of faith value. And so often, right, it's just how it looks. And we're like, God, I can't see how you're going to use this. I can't see how you're going to fix this. Guess what? That's the perfect time for God to move. Because God's like, oh, you know what? Yeah, now you out of my way. Y'all remember, I mean, how many of y'all grew up and y'all ever heard the statement, if somebody's standing in front of the TV and they're blocking your view, what do they say? Say it one more time. You are not made of glass, so your daddy is not a glassmaker, right? Because you are in the way. And sometimes we are in God's way. We need to get us out of the way so that God can move freely, right? Go sit down somewhere and let God be God. So, Pastor, how do I access this grace? You're talking about this thing. Do they got an app for it? Can I DoorDash it, right? Can I get grocery pickup for it, right? How do I get this? The way you access it is in your moment of weakness, tighten your grip on God. Tighten your grip onto God in your moment of weakness. See, I talked about spiritual disciplines a little bit last week, and I love the text here. It says, therefore, he said, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of what? Grace. That we may obtain mercy and find grace in the time of need. So what that tells me is that I'm supposed to be there. God is looking for me to approach him. He is looking for me to come to his throne of grace so that I can obtain grace and mercy in my time of need. So many of us never show up. We never approach. And the thing is that we should come boldly. God, I need some grace today. I need some mercy today. I'm here to redeem. You said brand new mercies every single day. I need my mercy for today, right? And I've learned this. We've got to come to the place of in our prayer lives that we're not just asking, but we are listening. And this week I've been focusing more on solitude, right? You know, I spend time praying, but it's like, God, well, what are you trying to say? You know, and we spend so much time just asking, but what is God trying to tell you? What is God trying to teach you? What is God trying to show you in your moment of weakness? So we've got to start praying for God's purpose over our preference. You see, Paul, he had a preference. He wanted the thorn to be removed. But God said, nope, I'm not moving this because my grace is sufficient. I'm going to use this. I'm going to move in this. And the thing about this is that you know you are growing when you start accepting God's instruction over your own interest. In other words, God's telling you this is what you really need to be doing, but you don't go and say, well, I'm growing. I'm going to do me anyway. No, I'm going to sit down right here, and I'm just going to be obedient, right? And the thing about it is you've got to learn how to hear God and how to listen to him. And he prayed for something to be removed, but God gave him a totally different answer. But it was the right one. And here's the thing, right? We got to get to the place where we start finding grace in every season. You see those solar panels up there, and the thing about solar energy is very powerful, right? But it only works when the sun is shining. And some of us only got to praise when the sun is shining. Some of us are only going to show up when the sun is shining in our lives. Some of us are only going to be faithful to God when we are getting what we want out of it. But the thing that you've got to understand is that God is good even when life is not. And sometimes there are seasons of life where we are being developed, where we are being disciplined, where God is doing something in us. And so many of us want to leave a season where God is still working. We can't just follow God when the sun is shining, y'all. And that's not discipleship. That's not what it means to follow Christ. Because the thing that you got to understand is that his grace is sufficient in the season that you are in. You see, so many of us want to leave before the process is finished. And I don't know about y'all, but when I was growing up, we didn't have a whole lot of money. We had enough. But understand something. Y'all know what it's like to drink Dr. Thunder and not Dr. Pepper. You know what it's like to have Toastios instead of Cheerios, right? We know, my dad used to go to Murray's Steak. Y'all remember Murray's back in the day? He'd go to Murray's Steak, and me and my brother ate everything that we could find. But he would go and get what he could afford, but we didn't have everything we may have wanted, but we sure had everything we needed. And you got to understand that sometimes the season of you not having everything you want is going to appreciate the season when you finally get there. Yeah. Yeah. See, if God gave you everything you wanted when you wanted it, we kill ourselves. I can go out and buy my son a car, right? We bought my daughter a car, and we've been praying ever since. But if I go and I buy Jaden a car, he'll kill himself, and he'll kill you too, right? If God gave you what you wanted, when you wanted it, you kill yourself. And we wouldn't see you ever again, right? But understand something. His grace is sufficient. On my job, you know, praise God, this week I got a promotion on my job. But here's the thing. So what I wanted to be full-time by now, right? I wanted promotions 2 years ago. But there was grace while the promise came. And the whole time, I'm like, God, I'm going to keep on tithing. I'm going to keep on giving. I'm going to keep on worshiping. I'm going to keep on trusting. I'm not going to have a pity party because my timing is not yours. Yeah. And understand something. In his infinite wisdom, he knows what I need and when I need it. Yeah. And I've got to be wise enough to be content right here and right now. And you got to be wise enough in your season to realize that it's still going to come, but it's going to come in his timing. So the thing that we got to see is you may feel weak right now. You may not have enough money right now, but that's teaching you how to appreciate what you do have, right? And I've learned this. I used to try to want my kids to have this, that, and the third, but all they really wanted was me. They cared about my time a whole lot more than they cared about my pocketbook. Yeah, they whining about, yeah, can we go here and have this and all that stuff, but they really cared and valued our time. So we got to get to the place where we are relying on grace in the season. Y'all, I'm going to give you this, and I'm getting out of your way. I'm going to take my seat. See, Paul said this. He left us with this. He says, for when I am weak, then I am strong. Now, I want to give you a lesson from the ant. Now, unfortunately, in my house, we had an ant issue this week. So I got phone calls from my wife. They're over here. You got to get here. You got to spray. She has bought 727 ant traps. I mean, the kids have emptied out bottles of, I ain't talking about a tss, tss. They're like, tss. Right? But here's the thing, right? The ant. The ant can carry 50 times its weight. It can carry 50 times its weight. The thing about it is, how do you carry all the weight on your shoulders? Some people can carry a whole lot of weight. People look at me like, man, how do you do it? How do you pastor church? How do you work your job? How do you coach your son's football team? How do you have your rental properties? How do you keep your wife happy, right? How do you do it all? Like, I don't know. It's grace, right? I pray a lot. But here's the thing. In order for you to carry the burdens you're carrying, so many of us are trying to carry it in our own strength. But God is saying, when you are weak, that's when I am strong. And so many of us have a loose grip on God and a tight grip on our problems. A loose grip on our faith and a tight grip on our fear. We got a loose grip on biblical community and a tight grip on everything else. But here's the thing. The ant can carry 50 times its weight. But the thing I love about the ant is the ant works together with other ants. So he will go out, he'll scout around and find one little thing, and he goes back and he tells everybody, y'all come on over here, they got greens, beans, tomatoes, come on, they got everything, you name it, they got it. And you started out with one ant, before you know it, you got a whole colony in your house, right? So they work in community, and what would it look like if we as believers... We're like, man, God is, I'm praying for you. I'm encouraging you. I'm supporting you. I'm giving you back. Look what God did in my life. God gave me this. God moved in the situation. If he did it for me, he can do it for you. Right? What would it look like if we worked together that way? But on top of that, the ant also uses its jaws. And we literally saw an ant crawling the other day, and we didn't know what it was. We saw a crumb that big walking along. And my wife was like, wow. The ant was like five times bigger than, the crumb was five times bigger than the ant, he's going. But he's carrying it in his jaws, and that spoke to me, y'all, because the thing about it is that in our jaws, in our mouths, we've got all of this power that we can praise with, that we can declare the promises of God with, that we can, but so many of us want to complain. We want to curse our situation. We want to talk down to our kids, down to our spouse. But we've got the power of life and death in our very tongues, and we can carry so much more if we could just fix our jaws. Yeah. Y'all, I'm done. Let's stop right here.
That's good.
There is strength in your weakness. There is strength in your weakness. See, your weakness is the perfect platform for God to show his strength. Maybe you're hanging on by a thread today. Maybe you're hanging on by a thread in your finances. You need to tighten your grip on God. Trust him at his word. Maybe you're hanging on by a thread in your marriage. It's time to tighten your grip on God and tap into grace. Maybe you're ready to give up. Tighten your grip on God. You see, he wants to use your situation to show the world just how good he is. See, my Bible tells me that not many wise are chosen, not many strong are chosen. God doesn't choose the best. He doesn't choose the people who have it all together. He chooses the weak. because His strength is made perfect in our weakness. Maybe you're saying today, Pastor, I just don't see how God could love somebody like me. I just don't see how God can fix this. You don't know what I've done. You don't know where my life has been. You really don't know. You're right, and I don't. But the Master of the universe, He does. And if God is wise enough to order every molecule that exists, if God is wise enough to hang the moon in its place, the sun where it goes, the clouds where they go, if He is wise enough to make every snowflake unique and different, who are we to think that God can't do something in us? His strength is made perfect in our weakness. Every head's bowed, every eye's closed, and Christians are praying. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and today you want to know Him, or maybe today you have drifted away from God, maybe you had a relationship with God, but you allow the stresses of life to cause distance, and today you're hanging on by a thread, but you know what? You want to reconnect. You want to tighten your grip. If that's you, you either don't know Jesus or you want to have a restored relationship with Christ. I want you to say this prayer with me. And as you say it, I want you to believe it in your heart so that you will be saved, so that you will be restored to fellowship with Jesus. Say this with me. Say, Lord, I am a sinner and I need Jesus. Say, I've messed up and I have made mistakes. I've sinned against you. I repent of those sins, and I want to have a relationship with you. I believe you died for me. I believe you paid the price for my sins, and you rose from the dead with all power in your hands. Say this with me. Say, come into my heart. Wash me clean. Live on the inside of me, and help me to live my life for you. Say this with me. Say, I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. Hey, if you prayed that prayer with me, I've got great news. The angels in heaven are rejoicing. The church here is rejoicing for you as well. And we want to help you to grow as a disciple of Jesus. If you prayed that prayer, I want you to see me at the end of church, because I want to help you to walk in community. I want to help you to have the resources that you need. Because I'm believing that God's going to build a testimony in your life. But sometimes that building happens best around others. So if that's you, I want you to see me at the end of church. I want to get some resources with you. I want to get you plugged in with some people who are going to help you to grow in your Christian journey. And now I want to open up the altar for those this morning who desire prayer. Maybe you're saying, Pastor, I am hanging on by a thread, and I hear what you're talking about God's strength, but all I feel is my weakness. I don't know how to pray. I don't know what to say. My situation feels way too big for me, but you know what? I just need some people. I need somebody to pray for me, Pastor. And if that's you, the altar is open for all who would come this morning, who want to experience grace and God's strength on a whole new level. If that's you, the altar is open for those who would come. Now, Father, we thank you, God, just for this time of hearing your word. I pray, Lord God, that you will seal the word in our hearts, that the enemy cannot steal it. God, I pray, Father, that you would allow it to produce fruit 30, 60, 100 fold for your glory. Father, we thank you that your grace has given us what we need. Help us to tap into it on a whole new level. God, I cannot wait to hear the testimonies. I cannot wait to hear the transformation. And we give you glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. I pray you got something out of today's message to take home with you. My prayer is that we are not just hearers of the word, but doers of what it says. So I want to encourage you to do what the word says, because the word works when you work the word. I know that to be a fact. We want to talk quickly about next steps. Maybe you've been coming for a while and you feel the need to call to connect to the church as a member. We would love to be your church family. I would love to be your pastor, right? We would love for BVCC to be the place you call home. We have seen more people connect to this church this year than we have ever seen before. And that's just a testament to God's faithfulness and his goodness. And if the Lord is calling you to do that, look, don't wait any more time. Go ahead and get that QR code, scan it. Let's get you plugged in, right? Because getting plugged in, I believe that healthy things grow, right? And God wants you to grow, and some of that growth takes place in community. So I want to encourage you to connect. Just grab that QR code, fill out the information, and we will get you plugged in to our next discipleship class. Maybe today you had a prayer request, though, and you didn't feel quite comfortable coming up here. You're worried about us putting oil all on your head and throwing you down on the ground, right? Maybe you're worried about those things, but you still have a prayer request. So I want you to grab that QR code and fill it out, because our prayer team is constantly praying, right? We have a team of intercessors who pray day in and day out for the needs of this church. So if that's you and you have a prayer need, please fill that out. Because we want to make sure we're praying over you. The Bible says that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. Prayer works, y'all. I wouldn't be standing here today if it wasn't for somebody praying for me. My grandmama prayed, my mama prayed, my cousin and them prayed, the Sunday school teacher prayed, the janitor prayed. They prayed for me. Understand something, prayer works, right? So I want you to grab that, fill out your prayer request, and our prayer team will be praying on your behalf. Lastly, though, we're going to talk about giving, because giving is an act of worship. Right. And when we give, right, we're not called to give God just the leftovers. Right. We're called to give God our first and our best. Right. And the Bible says that God loves what kind of giver? A cheerful giver. And that's what I talked about earlier, even during the sermon. Right. Sometimes in life we are walking through fear and not walking by faith. Right. We're looking at what we see. And sometimes there's too much month left over at the end of our money. Right. And we're like, man, I got to do this. I got to do that. But when you start to pay God first, God's funny math kicks in. I'm a product of that, y'all. I know God's faithfulness through giving. So I want to encourage you today to take a step of faith and give according to scripture and not according to somebody trying to manipulate you. I'm just going to give you Bible. Right. The Bible tells us that we ought to give cheerfully. Right. We ought to give sacrificially and we ought to give bountifully. Right. As we give those things, it talks about good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, what God will pour into your lap. I am seeing God do that in my life on so many ways. And it's because of his faithfulness to giving. So I want to encourage you to give God your best gift today. Our information is up here on the screen. You can give the QR code, the phone number. If you're old school, we got a box in the back for you too. But we want to thank God for your giving. And we are just so grateful, because God is faithful. He has blessed this ministry. We're doing great things in the community. People in the church don't have needs that are not being met because of giving, right? Giving. So I want to thank you for your giving. And we're believing God to do great things in your finances as well, as you partner with him to give him a portion of what he's already given to you. So we're going to get ready to have the benediction. We're going to get ready to wrap up. Y'all ready to go home?
Sure.
Okay. Well, all right. Y'all want part two? No, you're going to come back next Sunday, right? Come back next week. We're going to be back. We will be same place, same time. Also, we will have small group this week. So make sure you come to small group, because we're going to be talking about what we talked about today at a much deeper level. It is about discipleship, not about just coming to church, right? It is about growing. It's about maturing in our faith, right? So I want to encourage you to attend, and I'm just looking forward to what God's going to do through all of that. So I think the kids are in the back. I hope they survive back there. I heard a couple of thumps and bumps. But other than that, I didn't hear nobody screaming, and we didn't have to call 911. So we're going to get ready to have the benediction. I am just so blessed to have everyone today, and just looking forward to God doing great things. So let's look to the Lord together to be dismissed. God, thank you so much for this moment of worship. Thank you so much, God, for allowing us to come to church. Thank you for fellowship. Thank you for just being able to serve. God, we are so grateful for what you've spoken today, for being able to express our love to you and our love towards one another. I pray as we leave this place that our grip is tightened upon God. God, somebody today is going through a storm, and there are folks who have literally gone through roads washed away, no power, no food. But I pray, God, that your grace will be sufficient. Lord, we pray for those who are affected by the recent hurricane. And we pray, Lord God, your hand of grace upon them. We pray that you will send supplies, send needs, send encouragement. Most importantly, God, send your presence to realize, God, that no matter what we are going through, the sovereign hand of God is on our lives. So, God, as we leave this place, I pray we will never leave your presence. Make your face shine upon us, God, and give us your everlasting peace. We will be so grateful to give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. That concludes this morning's service. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming out today. First time guest, please see me. I got a gift for you. Make sure you hug on somebody on your way out. God bless.